Spectrum wants to hear your views. You can SMS at any time during the show. Type Spectrum, leave a space, type in your contribution and name, then send it to 7197. Your views, our interviews on Spectrum, Radio 1 FM 90.
A very warm welcome. This is Spectrum on Radio 1. I'm your host, Edmond Chizito. On Spectrum tonight, the Constitutional Court says the Inspectorate of Government has no powers to prosecute. What is the way forward now? A recent Constitutional Court interpretation has robbed the Inspectorate of Government of the powers to prosecute those implicated in corruption, a development that has reopened a ferocious debate on the determination by government to fight graft. The interpretation is to the effect that the Inspectorate of Government cannot carry out prosecution because it is not fully constituted as envisaged under Article 223 of the Constitution. This interpretation followed an application by Sam Kutesa, John Nasasira and Mwesigwa Rukutana, who challenged the authority of the Inspectorate to prosecute them, saying it was not fully constituted. This interpretation has also been questioned, given the fact that the same court had indicated that the Inspectorate had powers to prosecute when former Vice President Gilbert Bukenya made a similar application. Now, the power to constitute the Inspectorate is vested with the President, although Parliament plays the key role of vetting the appointees and also approving the budget of the Inspectorate. President Museveni has come under fire for failing to constitute the Inspectorate for the last 2 years, ever since the then substantive IGG, Faith Mwanda, reverted back to the judiciary, with many saying that this signifies that he is not determined to fight corruption. The President has, however, indicated that he has delayed to constitute the Inspectorate because he does not want to appoint a poacher as a game ranger. Strong words there. In Parliament, legislators have kick-started a process to push the President to take action, saying his delay is in total abrogation of the Constitution, which commands him to act immediately and not at his own pleasure. So tonight on Spectrum, we look at the decision of the court, how it impacts on the Inspectorate, and what it will take to deal with this quagmire that many say could have been avoided. Our guest tonight is Mr. Raphael Baku, Acting Inspector General of Government. You're most welcome, Mr. Baku.
Thank you, Edmund.
Mr. IGG, what does the ruling by the Constitutional Court actually mean?
Well, the ruling, according to the Constitutional Court, is that the Inspectorate of Government cannot perform its function of prosecuting culprits of corruption when it is not fully constituted. That's what they pronounced. According to the Constitution and the Inspectorate of Government Act, the Inspectorate of Government is supposed to comprise of the IGG and the two deputies. So their interpretation is that when the three principal officers are not in office, then the Inspectorate of Government cannot prosecute. But of course, what is really a fact is that the last 3 years have been acting Inspector General of Government. We have been prosecuting, and we have been prosecuting successfully. And we have got even more convictions over the last 2 years than all the previous convictions of the Inspectorate of Government put together. So in practical terms, definitely, the Inspectorate has been prosecuting and has been prosecuting competently. But that is the interpretation they give. For our side, we think there is a section under the Inspectorate of Government Act which provides that where the Inspectorate is supposed to do some act, that act can be done by the Inspector General or Deputy Inspector General on behalf of the Inspectorate of Government. So we have been operating on the basis that that section of the Inspectorate of Government Act, Section 32, empowers the Inspector General or the Deputy Inspector General to perform the functions of the Inspectorate of Government. And that's how we have been operating. And we think the Constitutional Court erred by saying that that the three principal officers must all be in office before the Inspectorate can act.
So do you think this was politically motivated? Some people think these people are too sensitive to be prosecuted, so they had to bend the law a little bit.
Well, I did not immediately feel that there was politics in it. I think there may be two ways of looking at the particular provision which I'm referring to. The Constitutional Court decided to look at it from one side, where they say the Inspectorate of Government should take a decision. Then the Inspector General of Government or Deputy will implement the decision of the Inspectorate of Government. Our own interpretation is that where the law requires the Inspectorate of Government to act, then the IGG or Deputy IGG could act on behalf of the Inspectorate of Government. So it is really a question of looking at that particular provision in relation to other provisions within the Inspectorate of Government Act and the Constitution.
So you don't think it's politics?
I don't think so.
You're not safe to say so.
I definitely do not think so, unless I get more facts, other facts.
Mr. Buck, what's the way forward?
And of course, we are not contented with the decision.
Yes.
We have certainly, we are aggrieved by the decision. So we'd like to take the matter to the Supreme Court, so that the Supreme Court can look at it and see whether that is a correct interpretation. Because once that is upheld, it would mean, even in the future, at any one time, the Inspector General of Government and the two deputies must always sit together to make decisions. So if one of them is, for example, indisposed, that means the inspectorate will not take decisions. If one is on travel, then the other two cannot take decisions because they gave an interpretation which gives an impression that they think there must always be unanimous decisions of the Inspectorate of Government. Because even under the laws of Uganda, there is no quorum for Inspector General, for the Inspectorate of Government to make
under any
decision.
Election laws.
There is no quorum at all. So for us, our interpretation is that the quorum is one, that any one of them present can execute the work of the Inspectorate of Government.
So technically speaking, right now the office does not exist.
Well, it exists, as far as we are concerned.
Well, you've been asked to hand over your files to the DPP.
Yeah, we have not been asked. We have been the ones who initiated. We think that the prosecutions which have been instituted should not be jeopardized because of that ruling. Under the laws of Uganda, anybody can prosecute. Even a private citizen can prosecute. That's why even the DPP has got powers to appoint public prosecutors from even private citizens. So we think the prosecutions should not be endangered. Therefore, we had a discussion with the DPP, and we have reached a position that the DPP appoints some of the lawyers within the Inspectorate of Government as public prosecutors. And now, in their capacity as public prosecutors, they will take over these cases and proceed with them.
So you'll take them to his office? You'll take some of your staff?
They don't have to go to the DPP's office. They can work from my office, but they get some guidance from the DPP when there is a need.
They get instructions from him?
When there is a need, yes.
Well, but functionally, he's taking them over, basically.
Yeah, but functionally, the law under which they're appointed says the DPP can appoint any public officer as a public prosecutor.
Yes.
And therefore, the person does not lose his status as an officer of a particular institution in order to be a public prosecutor. So the person enjoys those double capacity.
All right. I'd like you to take us through the process, what it would mean. It could maybe take 2 years or whatever. We'll talk about that in a short while. But in the meantime, the DPP...
No, the DPP has already appointed them.
No, we'll talk about that a little bit later. But let's look at the DPP's office. I mean, the functionality of this whole thing, this whole saga.
Yes.
The DPP's office is older than the IGG's office.
Yes.
Which means it was not efficient. It was not doing its work well.
That's
which
correct.
Is why the IGG was constituted.
Yes.
And now you're going back. You're going back some, turning the wheel back a little.
Well, not really. No, the DPP has got two powers. The first power the DPP has is to take over the proceedings, criminal proceedings, instituted by any person or authority. Once he takes over, he uses the officers he has under his office.
Yes.
Another option the DPP has, which he has exercised in this particular case, is not to take the workload and put it on top of the workload
he has
by all his officers. He appointed different persons from within the inspectorate as public prosecutors to take over these cases and proceed with them. So it has no impact on increasing the workload on the DPP's office.
No problem with that. But the point is the DPP was not sufficient, which is why they created your office. Let's look at a paragraph.
Yeah, but this is a temporary measure.
No problem. We'll talk about that. It's a little bit like the Uganda Revenue Authority created out of the Customs Department in the Ministry of Finance, and now they say the URA cannot collect taxes. They should take back the function of the Customs Department, which was failing in the first place.
Yeah, this one is a temporary measure. We are hoping that one of two things will happen sooner than later. First, properly constituting the Inspectorate of Government with IGG and the two deputy inspector generals, or the constitutional petition appeal which we have filed may resolve the problem. So we have taken this as an interim measure so that we don't clog the court system with the cases waiting there while these other matters are being sorted out.
Listeners, this is Spectrum on Radio 1 tonight. The Constitutional Court says the IGG or the Inspectorate of Government has no powers to prosecute. What is the way forward? And our guest is Mr. Raphael Bakwa, Acting Inspector General of Government. How long could this process take, the law process, the appeal in the Supreme Court? 3 weeks? 3 years?
Well, it can take any time from three weeks to several months. But my consolation is that the process with the DPP has not taken long. The public prosecutors have already been appointed, so they have started work.
So nobody is off the hook yet?
Nobody.
Certainly. Well, but we still have question marks of the functionality of the DPP's office, their ability to actually do the work.
Well, I am confident they will do it.
Politically confident?
I'm confident they will do it, and nobody is going to be let off the hook without answering to the criminal trials which have already been instituted.
The alternative is for the president to appoint a substantive to constitute the IGG fully, that is, affirm someone in the IGG's office and the two deputies.
That is, I also acknowledge that is another thing which
is it the best way to do it?
Oh, certainly it is.
And he says he can't appoint someone because he's yet to find someone he trusts.
Well, that is now his homework, really.
You don't want to talk about that. All right. What could have been done? I mean, he could have appointed these people. Why would it take such a long time? It doesn't always happen like that. 2 years. You've been working for 3 years. How has your performance been?
That's why I think it has been good. You should also be able to know the why.
Give us some figures then.
Now, during this period, the public confidence in the Inspectorate of Government has increased, and as a consequence of that, we have been receiving more and more complaints. For example, in the year 2009, the Inspectorate of Government received a total of 1,566 complaints. In 2009, the number rose to 2010. It rose to 2,082. In 2011, the number of complaints we received rose to 2,205. So people are increasingly coming to the Inspectorate of Government to bring their complaints, which means they are enjoying the confidence of the Inspectorate of Government. In terms of prosecutions and arrests we made, for example, last year we arrested about 120 people. In the year 2010, we arrested 70. That's compared with 24 in 2009 and 26 in 2008. The number of concluded cases in court have increased. Last year, 2011, we had 37 cases concluded in court. In 2010, we had 30 concluded, while in 2009, only 11 were concluded in court. And out of the concluded cases, in 2011, we had 29 convictions, while in 2010, we had 17, and 2009, we had one. So you can see the numbers of both of complaints, concluded cases, and convictions have risen steadily.
So you've stepped on too many toes, that it's time to shut you down.
That one is a plausible explanation for why we are being battered from all sides.
It's possible you've stepped on too many toes.
Certainly.
Now they want to shut you down.
Yeah, I think there is some effort to try to weaken the performance of the Inspectorate of Government. But we are not going to yield to that. That is why we very swiftly moved and took the decisions we have taken so that the fight against corruption is not stampeded, so that the people who are facing corruption prosecutions do not find opportunity to wriggle out of being tried.
At what level do you think this interpretation, this interference comes at?
Well, it comes from, I think, persons who are...
LC5, LC1, what level? Talk to us about
that. You know the people who are, we are prosecuting in court. You know the people who took this matter to the Constitutional Court. You know the others who are also there. So I think there are a lot of concerns from various angles, but we are not deterred. I think that is what the struggle against corruption is all about. Corruption is different from fighting AIDS, which does not react. Here you are acting against people who have got the capacity to react, people who have got the capacity to fight back. That's what makes it a war, because you are fighting and they are fighting back. So
you have to be a strong man.
You have to be determined.
Let's talk about Professor Bukenya's case. Professor Gilbert Bukenya, he spent some uncomfortable nights in jail in Luzira, and the same court apparently had ruled that he had the powers to prosecute him. Why the two standards?
Well, they explain it in the judgment which they delivered on the 5th of this month. The explanation is that in Bukenya's case, he was not challenging whether the inspectorate of government was properly or fully constituted or not. He was questioning whether the IGG, who is an acting person, which is unknown in law, can prosecute him. And the court's answer was that an IGG who is acting, but who is substantively a deputy, can perform the work of the IGG and the work of the inspectorate of government. Therefore, that IGG who is acting can prosecute. And that was how the matter was resolved.
And how are you constituted? Let's look at the constitution. How is the IGG's office constituted?
I mentioned it. IGG plus two deputies.
IGG plus the two deputies?
Yeah.
And when you're not, you know, fully constituted, what does the constitution say specifically?
It doesn't say anything.
It's quiet.
Yeah.
How about other laws?
They're also quiet.
So they took advantage of a lacuna?
I don't think it is a lacuna. That's why I've been talking about this section 32. This section 32 of the Inspectorate of Government Act reads, subject to this act, where an instrument or document is required or authorized to be issued by the inspectorate, or any act is required or authorized to be done by the inspectorate in the performance of its functions under this act, the instrument or document or act may be signed, executed, or done by the inspector general or a deputy inspector general, or any person authorized in writing by the inspector general or by a deputy inspector general. So for us, our interpretation, not only this time when I have been acting inspector general, even before
when you were deputy,
when I was a deputy, our interpretation was that a deputy can fully discharge the functions of the inspectorate of government, and the IGG can also fully discharge, so that we don't have to meet to discuss a case to take a common decision. For example, if I supervise a particular investigation and I reached a position that this investigation has resulted into proving somebody is culpable, I would take the person to court without having to convene a meeting between the IGG and the deputy IGG to make a decision before the matter goes to court. And vice versa, the IGG can do that. So we really, the inspectorate of government, even Mr. Ruzindana, the Honorable Ruzindana, has acknowledged today in the newspapers that even during his time,
it was the first IGG.
Yes, during even his time, they were operating independently of each other. So then that has been the tradition. So it is wrong, we think, to now for the court to come and prescribe a procedure within the inspectorate of government that will require the inspector general and two deputies to sit together to make collective decisions.
All right.
When does it bog down the operations of the institution once it is adopted as a modus of operandi?
All right. We understand there's a new process that has been launched in Parliament. We'll talk about that later. But first of all, can you take us through this appeal process? How exactly does it work?
Well, the first thing we have done is to launch a notice of appeal. And when we launch the notice of appeal, we have asked for copies of the judgment, which we have got. Then we have asked for a record of the proceedings. Now, once we get the record of the proceedings, which means the detailed record of what transpired in court during the hearing process, we would then study the record, and then we come up with the memorandum of appeal. And once the memorandum of appeal is ready and filed in court, then it depends on the program of the court when the appeal can be set down for hearing.
So that detailed hearing, the detailed record, you can't move anywhere without it?
Without it, no.
And it might take 2 years because they don't have typists.
Well, I think they will do it faster.
They might not have typists, you never know.
Yeah, they
civil services sort of stuff.
They will type. We don't have a problem with that. We know the Court of Appeal is a serious court. We have given them the notice. We have made official request for it. So there is no reason why they should not expeditiously prepare the record and hand it over to us.
So you've taken it to the Court of Appeal?
No, we are taking it. The Constitutional Court is at the same time the Court of Appeal of Uganda. So the appeal which we are making will go to the Supreme Court.
The final court?
The final court of the land.
So what they rule is final?
Yeah.
So we might have the IJJ's office or we might not, depending on what they say?
Yes, please. That's true.
Do you think you have a case or the sharks will go up to that level?
Well, we shall wait to see. I think we have a good case. We shall wait to see.
Some people will say you didn't foresee this. How come you never foresaw it? You could have created other laws to protect the office.
No, even if we foresaw it, making laws is outside our capacity.
Well, you could if
laws are made by Parliament, and
you could originate them, you know.
But we did not think there was a problem. Actually, we thought the section of the Inspectorate of Government Act, which is made because of the mandate of the Constitution, which provides that Parliament shall enact laws to enable the Inspectorate of Government to perform its functions efficiently and effectively. We thought that mandate was used by Parliament, and the Parliament has made that particular provision in order to expedite performance of the work of the Inspectorate of Government and to ensure that even when the Inspectorate of Government has vacancies within it, the work should go on so long as there is a deputy or IGG in office.
Listeners, this is Spectrum on Radio, and we're going for a break. We'll be back. But stay tuned.
When Junior lost his appetite, his mother tried all methods to get him to eat. She tried scary stories.
Eat, Tommy, eat, or the big black elephant will come and eat all your food.
She tried magic.
Tommy, if you eat your food, I will turn this handkerchief into sweets. Look, bumble, bumble, boom, boom.
Then, she discovered Apetol multivitamin syrup with lysine.
Mommy, I finished all the food. I am number one.
Apetol multivitamin with lysine is helping mothers to turn mealtime frustration to a fun moment. Apetol has a great taste and contains lysine, which quickly improves your child's appetite and supports healthy growth. Apetol, health for life.
John, Mike and I, we go back a bit. We knew John at the beginning, working for someone else. But he was different. He had vision, saw opportunities. He started working towards his goal, opened his own garage, and worked, learning the hard way. His reputation spread. Trust, consistency, quality. Soon people were coming to him from all parts. He made himself and his whole street prosper and also helped friends, seeing potential in people and helping them on. But John never shouts about all his success. He's just who he is. Special.
So here's to men like John, who make a difference, who enjoy Nile Special, the rich, satisfying taste from the source. Nile Special. You've earned it.
Not for sale to persons under 18.
Special fares to the US, London, China, and India, with extra baggage allowance on selected flights. To book your flight, contact your local travel agent or call us on 041-7800-900 or book online at QatarAirways.com/UG.
Qatar Airways, world's five-star airline.
Terms and conditions apply.
Radio 1, FM 90.
Welcome back on Spectrum. Tonight, the Constitutional Court says the Inspectorate of Government has no powers to prosecute. What is the way forward now? Our guest is Mr. Raphael Baku, Acting Inspector General of Government. You will be able to call in and contribute to this discussion. Mr. Baku, we understand that there is a process in Parliament to try and get things sorted out. What do you know about this?
I am not aware. But of course, I know when the Parliament was debating the Public Accounts Committee report on the harbour compensations, they passed a resolution to say that the President should fully constitute the Inspectorate of Government expeditiously. That's what I know. After that, I don't know whether there are new efforts to make causing the president to act.
And they can't, because you have no say in it. You can only, fold your hands and wait.
Yeah, but I'm sure the president is fully aware of what is going on, so there is not much we can do ourselves as from the inspectorate of government.
Do you have cases of corruption inside of your own office?
Well, it has not come to my attention. Nobody has come to me to say so and so in your office is corrupt, except there was people who have been attempting to compromise our officers by bribes, but at least I'm happy that the officers have been with sufficient integrity to report them, and we have been able to prosecute 3 people who have attempted to bribe our officers, and they were convicted.
So you don't have corruption?
Then, we have, at a certain point, at a lower level among drivers, we found some people who came to the inspectorate of government with the forged academic documents, because we require drivers to be at least the senior 4 leavers.
Yes.
Yeah, but we found some of them came with the forged documents, and as soon as we realized them, we also prosecuted them like other people who had forged documents. So they were convicted also.
And your staff, are they well paid?
We are not well paid. We are still working on that. We are making some progress in improving the terms of and conditions of service of the staff. And we hope we will get where we intend to get.
At least be able to double their salaries.
Yeah, we are working to improve it, really.
You want to double it? So an office messenger, I guess, at least 1 million shillings.
Certainly, that will be very good if we can achieve that.
If a messenger can get 1 million shillings,
yes,
every month.
Mm-hmm.
What does the future hold? When you look at this whole thing, how do you see it? 4 months down the road, what do you think is when you close your eyes, as someone who's been there for a long time, how do you think it's going to unfold?
No, I think the problem will be solved sooner than later.
You think the Supreme Court 3 months from now will have ruled? Or even less?
Either that or the president, I think, would have acted, because certainly the situation has gone on for too long. Personally, I did not expect it to go this long. I thought it would take not more than 6 months by the time I took responsibility for the inspectorate of government. But for reasons which I'm not able to explain, I think it has gone to this extent. And now that there is a lot of concern from all the quarters, including parliament, including donors, I was reading the president, even they raised it to the president, I think he's going to act soon.
You think he might appoint someone tonight as we speak?
Well, I can't say tonight.
Well, it's an emergency right now. So you think it's going to be resolved one way or the other? You might have to go to court. You might not have to go to court if the president appoints.
No, but even if the president appoints, we still have to go to court, because that decision which says the inspector of government for it to make decisions, the IGC and the 2 deputies must sit together always, I think is not a good decision. First of all, it makes the work cumbersome. Secondly, it amounts to the court prescribing how the inspectorate should function.
Yes.
While the preserve of how the inspectorate should function is within the inspectorate itself.
It should be an internal matter.
The government is by law, by constitution, an independent institution which has got its own rights to determine how it should proceed in discharging its functions. So it was wrong for the court to prescribe how the inspectorate should decide or operate.
So even if the president appoints the right people, you still go back to court?
Certainly,
to challenge.
We are not go back. We are already there. We shall continue to be there
until
the matter is resolved.
So how can your office be protected even after this? What lessons would you learn, and how can it be strengthened?
Well, first of all, of course, it can be strengthened by removing ambiguities. For example, that section 31, which I said the courts interpreted in one way, for us we have been looking at it in another way. So that it require that provision. If it is not clearly resolved by the Constitutional Court, not the Supreme Court, then it must be amended to make it clear what the Parliament intended to provide. Then, other than that, there should be mutual respect of institutional independence. The courts should respect the independence of the Inspectorate of Government, Parliament should respect independence of the Parliament of Inspectorate of Government, even the executive should respect, so that it lives to the expectation of the constitution which vested it with independence.
Do you get a lot of interference, phone calls in the night?
No, really. I think at the individual level, I have not got any interference with my performance.
Really?
Yeah, no.
Did you get a fair hearing in this case?
Well, we thought we got a fair hearing, but of course my lawyers who argued the case observed that the arguments which they made are not fully captured in the ruling. That is why the record is very important, even for the appellate court, to look at actually what arguments were raised and whether they were sufficiently addressed by the constitutional court.
So 2 months down the road, you might get this hearing, or you think it might take a shorter time?
I really don't want to guess how long it will take.
Well, there are precedents in other places.
Yeah.
You don't want to speculate then?
No, because I know there is also a problem a bit in the Supreme Court. I think the Supreme Court also has got quorum
issues. Well, but they have a Judicial Service Commission now.
The Judicial Service Commission is now working on recruiting judges to the Supreme Court. I hope that process will not also unduly delay.
So you're talking about 9 months, basically?
No, really,
minimum.
I don't want to
give us an idea.
I cannot give.
It can't be 3 weeks.
I don't have any criteria on which to give definite periods.
Let's talk about the leadership code, implementing the leadership code. Following the ruling of the Luchamzi case, Parliament is yet to put in place a tribunal. Are you still using the leadership code?
Yes, we are still using the leadership code. We are getting declarations of leaders. We are investigating complaints against leaders, especially complaints relating to amassing of wealth. And of course, when the Chambers case came in, another good development was that the Anti-Corruption Act was also enacted. And under the Anti-Corruption Act, some of the conducts which amounted to breach of the leadership code were transferred from the Leadership Code Act to the Anti-Corruption Act as offenses. Conduct like conflict of interest is now an offense under the Anti-Corruption Act. So if a leader is found to be in conflict of interest, instead of dealing with him under the Leadership Code Act, we will now deal with him under the Anti-Corruption Act through prosecution for conflict of interest. An offense like illicit enrichment has been created under the Anti-Corruption Act. So if you find a leader has got wealth so much beyond what he can explain,
yes,
reasonably, how he has accumulated the wealth, it can be prosecuted for illicit enrichment. So there are other avenues which have opened up through which the Leadership Code Act can be enforced even more vigorously than what was under the Leadership Code Act. Because under the Leadership Code Act, there are only administrative actions that can be taken. Now, prosecution can also result from Leadership Code investigations.
And how vigorously do you intend to pursue this?
As vigorously as our human resource strength can permit.
How strong are you in terms of human resources?
Not so much. We have been asking to increase our staff levels, but Minister of Finance has been advising it is not possible to increase because it will increase the wage bill, and they are not ready to sustain increasing the wage bill through increasing numbers at the same time as they are trying to increase the wage bill through salary enhancement. So we are still working more on salary enhancement, and at the same time we are trying to build the capacity of the staff who are already there through various training programs so that they are able to perform their functions much more competently than before.
Can you give us an idea of how understaffed your office is?
By our current establishment, if we fill the vacancies there fully, we will require additional about 100 officers.
100? How big is the staff now?
About 300.
So you're talking about 25% extra staff?
Yeah, sure.
And the government says they don't have money to do it. Have they given you a timeline? Maybe 3 years they'll be able to...
No, not yet.
So you might get them, you might not get them.
Not immediately. Anyway, we have been discussing. So we are still waiting for example, the indicators for the next financial year. We have made some proposals. We are still waiting for the response of the Minister of Finance.
So you've submitted your plans and are waiting to hear from them?
Yes.
So at the moment you can't get wealth declaring its owners in terms of the leaders?
No, they keep on declaring, but the only problem we have is that because of our staff constraints, we cannot verify the declarations as much as we would like, we want to. So the percentage of declarations that we can actually cross-check in terms of trying to establish whether the declarations are truthful, that is a very small percentage.
So sometimes you get declarations that you can't verify, you can't visit the places where the houses are and so on.
Yeah.
Do you have cases where disproportionate amounts are declared, or do people under declare as well?
No, there is the declarations which are made tend to be commensurate with the income.
Yes.
Our suspicion is that probably some of the wealth or properties that may indicate wealth above the known income or the justifiable income may be concealed. Otherwise, most of the leadership code verifications we have done say, well, this is almost the income declared.
Most people have been declared from
official sources, right, and from what they claim to be other business sources, especially what they claim to be informal business, because where
like
you
sugar
have,
and other things.
Like sugar, like crops, selling produce, selling cows, then you find it difficult.
So some of the salaries that some people get might be small change in the end because they deal with sugar and so on.
Yeah.
How about their relatives? Some of them might have 6 months children who own factories.
Well,
a six-month-old child.
The law requires that
with the factory to his name,
declare or on the assets of their dependent children. Most of them don't declare them with assets.
They don't declare them with assets?
No.
So you don't have a six-month-old child owning a factory or an import business.
Mm-hmm.
Apart from the ongoing trial of the three people who caused this crisis, you had promised to succeed with the other Chogam cases. Bukenya was set free. You did not appeal. So some people are saying you were actually used to punish the old man.
No, we are not used. I think if any keen observer of the trial would have realized that the trial which we conducted, where he was acquitted, was doomed to fail when we were not allowed time by the courts to bring the witnesses we wanted to bring from Kenya. We asked for an adjournment to permit us to bring witnesses from Kenya. The court says no, we have no time to give adjournment. Either you bring the witnesses within this week or you close your case. So we did not have all the evidence we intended to bring on record, and therefore I was not surprised when he was acquitted.
And you don't have any intentions of appealing?
Well, you can't appeal when the evidence is not on record.
You cannot appeal.
Mm.
So it's a dead case. He's a free man right now.
That one is true.
Let's talk about your investigation. Because you do prosecutions, but you also do investigations. What's going to happen to that? The court ruling affects prosecution.
The ruling did not affect prosecution. This is specifically about prosecution.
It's specifically about prosecution.
Yes.
It does not affect investigation.
No. So our investigations will continue.
You pass it on to the DPP.
Yes.
Who has officers in your office as well.
Yes, right.
Well, listeners, this is Spectrum on Radio 1. Tonight, again, the Constitutional Court says the Inspectorate of Government has no power to prosecute. We're asking what is the way forward now, and the person to answer those questions is Mr. Rafael Baku, Acting Inspector General of Government. You can call in now. Our numbers, 0414-348-111, 0312-260-390, 0312-261-390. When you call in, please tell us your name and where you are calling from. Hello, Spectrum, hello. Yes?
Edmund.
Yes, my friend.
Good evening.
Good evening to you.
I just feel sorry for...
reception. Hello. Yes, your name?
Yes, my name is Hussein.
Yes. Spectrum, hello. Good evening, your name? Dickens, yes. Spectrum, hello? Yes, sir. Can you switch off your radio, walk away from it?
Okay, good evening.
Good evening, your name?
My name is James.
Yes, James. Hello, your radio is giving us feedback. It's better if you walk away from it as you speak. Okay, let's get back to the studio. Honorable Baku.
Yes, please.
Does our country need prayers that badly? Yes, so you can respond to them as they came in.
Oh, now, some of them I am not sure require a response. But what I can pick on the following. The first contributor who says there's a problem with the institution building, yes, that is true. I think we should all focus on the building institutions. But the need is there. We certainly need to develop our institutions at all levels. In public service, in the private sector, we are weak in many things. One of the reasons why corruption is prevailing in Uganda is because the anti-corruption institutions are inadequately supported, both in terms of finances and also in terms of cooperation with the members of the public.
Yes.
There have been cases where people made complaints to us, we investigate, and when the matter is concluded and we have taken the matter to court for prosecution, the very persons who initially complained would resist going to give evidence in court.
How do you explain that?
I don't know. There have been two cases where I had to issue warrant of arrest to bring people to court to come to testify, while they are the ones who initiated the investigations by lodging a complaint with us. So our people need to be encouraged to stand up and defend the public interest with zeal. So we should work not only for the Inspectorate of Government, but even for other public institutions, to really build institutions and to build courage in our people so that they are able to act without fear or favor. The Dickens talked a lot about a case he reported. Of course, I cannot answer this one off head. We have a lot of complaints within the Inspectorate of Government. I was giving figures that in 2011 alone, we got 2,205 complaints. And this is in addition to a backlog which we brought forward from the previous periods. So right now, our backlog or total number of cases we are handling within the Inspectorate of Government is over 5,000.
Case backlog of 5,000?
Yes.
Over
5,000. And so it is possible that where the matters are very complicated investigations, they take longer than the ordinary, which would be more expedited. But don't lose heart. If the matter is still outstanding, you can come back to me. We will still see where the obstacles are, and we can explain to you where our problems are, and if we see the way forward.
And if he's stepping on too many toes, you'll tell him.
Yes, also, we'll tell him. And of course, now...
Can you explain that to a little bit?
The another thing where why people don't report cases of corruption, or sometimes they don't cooperate in a prosecution of corruption cases, has been fear. Fear of victimization by the corrupt. Because people who engage in corruption are generally powerful people. They have resources, although they are illegal and resources, they can use them for victimization. That's why the government has put in place the Whistleblowers Protection Act. The Whistleblowers Protection Act is supposed to protect whistleblowers, people who bring information in confidence. And that is now where another problem is. There are some people who have complaints against certain people, but they breach the rules of confidence themselves.
How do they do it?
They write a complaint,
yes,
to the Inspectorate of Government and give copies to other institutions.
Right.
So you cannot protect. Who they think should know. So they expose themselves as the complainants, and then they come to be intimidated, and they come to be threatened, and so on and so on. So my advice is that where a complaint is brought in confidence, there is a protection under the Whistleblowers Protection Act.
Yes.
Which requires that the person who receives such information in confidence should not disclose the identity of the one who brings the information. That is to protect the informer. And there are other protections which are available. So we should be careful, because the corrupt can fight back. We work in conjunction with each other, but we should maintain confidentiality.
All right. James Kayondo says he did not quite get convinced about the Kenya case.
Well, actually, I'm not the best person to explain that case.
It's the Attorney General.
Not the Attorney General. It is the spokesperson of the judiciary. This is a decision of the judiciary, and this will be explained by the judiciary. What I was mentioning is what they stated in the judgment of the Kutesa's petition. Because they also were conscious that there is apparent contradiction. That they are conscious, they mentioned it, they tried to distinguish the decision they made in the Bukenya's case from the one of the Kutesa's case. But the best person will be the spokesperson of the judiciary who should explain that. Then, of course, the question of only prosecuting Bukenya. I have not only prosecuted Bukenya.
Even Chay was prosecuted.
In the time I have been in the Inspectorate of Government, I have lodged a prosecution of more than 200 people.
Yes.
Because in 2010, we had a total of 116 prosecutions going on.
Yes.
In 2011, by the end of the year 2011, we had 154 prosecution cases going on. Right now, we have over 160 prosecution cases going on.
Yes.
So Bukenya was just one individual among others.
One among many, regardless of the size. Well, we have to end here. Thank you very much, Dida. Dear guest, Mr. Raphael Baku, Acting Inspector General of Government, thank you very much for coming to Spectrum tonight. Thank you for tuning in. I've been your host, Edmond Chizito. Spectrum will be back tomorrow. Up next is the news in English.
And welcome to the Theatre of Dreams, which is Manchester United, Old Trafford.
Here's Rooney! Oh my goodness!
Win an all-expenses-paid trip to watch Manchester United live at Old Trafford. Dial